happened to dust, still, I know you are good. Your hand is just. So come now, be the salvation for my sins. Help me to begin again, that you would mend this trend of hopeless. God, deliver me in my brokenness. I can feel your presence, even now in the ugly, in the mess that has been made. You surround me with your benevolence. Yes, your love is on display, and I can see it. Carving roads through the struggles and the troubles, past temptations and devices that seek to choke me out. So come fear, come failure, come opposition or doubt. Jesus, you are my deliverance. Your grace is sufficient. Trusting you is my only way. Now I turn my mind to dwell on your truth. Curate the condition of my heart to manifest joy. Be my living proof. Subdue the haters. Quell the voices inside. Transform me, Lord. Extinguish my pride. You've won the battle. I trust in your plans. Yes, God. I surrender all my worries, my woes, and my demands into your eternally capable hands.
Thank you all for just bearing with us. We have a few technical difficulties tonight. I am doing part two of a sermon series. Well, not part two, but part two for today. Our sermon series is called Battle Ready. And this morning I began a sermon that was called Seated at the Table. And so I'm going to go back and kind of recap some of that for you. But I'm giving you a part two. There was so much in it, so much meat this morning in it, that I really needed to just completely just kind of go a little bit slower at a slower pace to really give you the meat of everything, because I know that there are some things that God is really wanting for us in this series. So to be battle ready, there are battles going on in the heavenlies over us. I want you to really grab hold of that. That the enemy is after your heart. The enemy is after your destiny. The enemy is after your eternity. And there is this war raging in the heavenlies, and it is a battle between good and evil. It is a battle between heaven and hell, between God and Satan. But we win. The battle is already won because of the blood of Christ, because of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. We win. We know that we've won. We've won even before the battle took place. We won even before we were birthed into this world. We already won because of Christ's victory. So there are two questions that I am really wanting you to address and really just kind of evaluate in your own lives throughout this series. First question is are we really ready for the battle? No matter who you are, there are battles that we face in our life. So are we ready? Are you ready for the battle that you are facing in your life? Do you know how to pray it through? Do you know how to fast it through? Do you know how to draw closer to the Lord? Are you ready for battle? Can you spiritually fight this out? Because the battle that we are fighting is not against flesh and blood, but it's against principalities. So we need to be prepared, and we need to know how to fight it out. And then the second question is, are we fierce enough to face the enemy head on? Are we fierce enough to look Satan in the face and say, get away from me. Get away from me. You can't touch my family. You can't touch my home. You can't touch my finances. This is not yours. I am God's chosen. I am a royal priesthood. I am a part of God's family, and you cannot touch me. I am completely encapsulated by the blood of Christ, And I know that because of who I'm connected to, because of my relationship with Christ, that you cannot touch me. And are we fierce enough to really face that battle? But there is a spiritual battle that is going on. So before I go any further, I want to just open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for tonight. I thank you for your presence that we felt throughout worship tonight, Lord. I pray, God, that you would just open up everybody's ears to hear, that you would open up our eyes to see, that we would begin to see supernaturally into our lives, into our families' lives, that we would know specifically what we need to do, how we need to pray, what moves we need to make. Let this sermon be food from heaven, Lord. I ask you to use me in the next few minutes to just speak a word that you have for your people. Lord, I ask you to come down and to just be God in this moment, to say whatever we need to hear in order for us to draw closer to you. Lord, that's what we want. We want to draw closer to you tonight. We do not want to spend eternity in hell. We do not want to take a step back, but we want to draw closer to you. We thank you for all that you're doing. We thank you for your presence we've already felt, and we ask you to just continue to bless this service tonight. In the name of Jesus, we say amen. Amen. So going to the Word of God, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 2, and then I'm going to jump down to verses 7 through 10, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. So 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 2, and then I'm going to jump down and read 7 through 12, reading in the New Living Translation, just because it's a little bit of an easier translation to read. It's more readable. So starting at verse 2, I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know. Only God knows. Even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God, so to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from becoming proud. Three different times I begged the Lord to take it away. Each time he said, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults, the hardships, the persecutions and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Verse 2 says, Paul was caught up into the third heaven. That implies, as I said to you this morning, it implies that there are different levels of heaven, that there is a third heaven. If there's a third heaven, there must be a first heaven, and then there must also be a second heaven if there is a third heaven, just because of the logic behind of that. So if we just kind of think about it from our standpoint here on earth, just standing here as I am today, if we were to go outside and to look up, the sky that we can see with our natural eye would be considered the first heaven. And then beyond that would be the second heaven, where Satan was cast down to after he was removed from the throne of God, after he was removed from heaven, like it said in Revelation 12 this morning as I read to you. And then the third heaven is really the throne of God, that throne room of God, where I talked to you this morning about being seated at a table, that when we are in connection with Christ and we understand our authority and we understand our power and we understand our worth and who we are as a Christian, that we are seated at that table and we can remain at that table with the power, with the authority that God has given us, and we can fight from that location always and forever. In verse 2, it says that this happened 14 years ago. 14 means double completeness. It means to set everything in complete order. It is double 7. So it means it's God's complete number, or 7 double, or 7 double twice, however you want to say that. 14 also means deliverance, and it goes back to linking it to the Passover, where the death angel passed over the Hebrew homes in the Exodus. So I believe that God is saying that he's completing things for us, but he's also delivering things for us. So life is about cycles. There are cycles that we go through in life, and life is about cycles. There's different levels. We go from glory to glory. We go from different levels, from different cycles, and we grow in our walk with the Lord. Our Christian walk is about becoming spiritually mature so God can fully use us in the kingdom of God to win the lost and to be a blessing to others. Think about that. If we just get saved and sit on a pew and that's all we do, we are really not completing the Great Commission as we are called to do. That our Christian walk is about becoming spiritually mature. There's a maturing that takes place so that God can fully use us, because He wants to use us to bring peace, to bring comfort, to bring salvation to other people. I realize that we can only be saved through Jesus Christ, but there are many times where we can present the gospel message to a coworker, to a family member, to a friend, to somebody in the grocery store, and because of that connection, they will accept Christ. God wants us to use us that way to help us. He wants us to be an instrument that He can use to actually win the lost and to be a blessing to others. So I told you this morning that God wants to take us higher, that He has been wanting to elevate us, and that He wants to take us from glory to glory. But the enemy wants to devour us. But he'll lose every time when we understand our worth, when we understand who we are in Christ. I know that I am a child of the Most High King. I know that I am worthy. I know that I am connected to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords because of my relationship with Jesus Christ. I am a part of a royal family. I have royal blood that flows through my veins. I am a new creation. It's time to recognize our identity of who we are. I know that I am worthy. You are worthy. We are worthy. We are children of the Most High God. We are co-heirs with Christ. We are free to be all that God has called us to be. There is a calling that takes place. And no matter what we do, there is a calling. There is a destiny that we will achieve before we breathe our last breath. God, if there's something else left for me to do, give me the wisdom. Show me what it is I need to know. I am chosen. I am chosen. I talked to you about this morning. I know that I am chosen. I know that there are people that are in the congregation. I know that there could be people that are watching. But I know that we struggle with the concept of being chosen. If we have been rejected in our past, it is hurtful. We turn and we walk away from people to build up walls around our heart because of the pain that we've incurred. And that is to just build up a wall so that we won't be hurt again. So I know that there are people out there, but I want you to know that you are chosen, that you are chosen by the Most High God. I don't care if you were put up by adoption from as a child, as an infant. You were chosen by the Most High God. You were planned. You were created because God had a plan for your life. You are chosen. We are God's masterpiece, and we are anointed to do great things. I know that God loves me. I know that He wants to spend time with me. I know that I am created in God's image, and I know that my past does not determine my future because I am a new creation in Christ. I am redeemed. I am forgiven. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. And because of all of those things, I have a seat at His table. There is a seat with my name on it, and that seat cannot be taken away. It is not anybody else's seat. It is my seat. It is your seat because of the blood of Jesus. That seat at His table is there for us, and it's marked for us, and it cannot be taken away. It cannot be removed, and He wants to sit there with you. He wants to sup with you. He wants to spend time with you. He wants to give you revelation. He wants to give you wisdom. He wants to give you knowledge. Supernatural knowledge from the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.
But if I don't know who I am in Christ, I won't know where I am with Christ. I want you to understand that. If you don't understand that you have a seat at that table, if you don't understand that you are right there with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, you will not understand who you are, and you won't understand where you are. Because when you know where you are, when you know that you are seated at that table, when you know that you are a part of a royal family, that carries provision with it. There are things that cannot happen to you because of connection with God. There is a position that you possess. There is a victory that you possess because you are connected to the King of Kings. Because there is victory attached to you, not because of who you are, but because of whose you are. You are a part of the family of Christ. You are a part of the family of God. You are victorious. My position gives me authority. My position gives me authority. My position gives me power. If I don't believe who I am, I will not exercise my authority from that high place of authority. I won't know where I'm at. I won't fight. I will fight on my own. I will fight naturally instead of supernaturally. I will fight, and I will fight from a fleshful standpoint. And because of that, it'll create more problems than it will solving solutions or giving you solutions to problems. If we do not understand where we are at, where we are fighting from. So you have the right to exercise authority from the throne room of God, from the table of God. We have dominion over the devil because we're seated at God's table, at his throne. God's table is above all principalities, above all power, above all. It is, we have dominion to rule and to reign with God. And God wants us to know that we are above the devil and he is below us, that we can trample on his head, that we can trample on the head of the enemy, that there isn't anything that he can do, that there isn't any way that he can attack us that is going to be successful, because at the end of this battle we win because of the victory of Christ, because of our connection. So when we go back to the thorn of the flesh, when we go back to verse 7 where it says, go back and read it. Even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God, so to keep me from being proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from becoming proud. Think about that. You know, so many times people focus on the thorn of the flesh. They ask themselves, well, I wonder what Paul had. I wonder what his thorn was. You know, I want to know what his thorn was. I wonder if his thorn is like my thorn. I wonder if we have the same things working in our lives. I was having a conversation with a Christian friend this week, and I said, which one of the disciples do you identify with the most? And she said, Peter. She goes, how about you? I said, same. Same. So sometimes we just look for those ways that we can identify. We ask ourselves questions about the Word of God. And so I was just wondering, you know, a lot of times people think about Paul's thorn, and they're wondering. But in this instance, I really want to focus in on the second part of that verse. A messenger from Satan was sent to torment him and to keep him from becoming proud. To keep him from becoming proud. Think about that. A messenger was sent from Satan. My torment is keeping me moving in the direction of God. Next time when you're going through something significant, do you think about that? Do you think about that now as you're moving through something that's difficult? Do you think about, okay, God's allowing this so that I can draw closer to him? Because that's really what's happening. God's allowing it so that we can draw closer to him, to keep us moving in his direction, to keep us moving from glory to glory. Think of it this way. There's a battle in the heavenlies over little old me, over little old you. There is a battle in the heavenlies over little old me and over little old you. You know what that means? It means that we are worthy. We are worthy. We are worthy. That should let you know that you are worthy. God and the enemy are fighting over you. You are worthy. So how are they actually fighting over you? It goes back to last week. It goes back to our thoughts. If the enemy can capture your mind, he can capture your life. It goes back to our thoughts. Things are being planted in our minds. There's something being produced in our minds, in our thoughts. We're going to produce some kind of fruit, either good fruit or bad fruit, out of our thoughts. Our thoughts lead to our words. Our words lead to our actions. Repeated actions lead to our habits. Habits lead to our character, and character leads to our destiny. You'll know them by their fruit. You'll know them by their fruit. When you live by the Holy Spirit, it guides our lives. In Galatians 5, 19 through 23, I want to show you the differences between the just fleshly things that can happen in our lives and then following it up with the fruit of the Spirit. Starting in verse 19, Galatians 5, verse 19 through 23, again reading from the New Living Translation. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that any living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. That sounds scary, doesn't it? That because of those bad choices that all start with the thought, it leads to other sin. That thought leads to sin, it leads to our actions, it leads to bad choices, it leads to our destiny, and that destiny can take us into a pit of hell, into an eternity of hell, where we will not inherit the kingdom of God. Verse 22, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Think about this. What are you producing? What kind of fruit are you producing? What kind of fruit are you producing? What are you choosing with your thoughts? What lifestyle are you choosing with your thoughts? Are you choosing to love, or are you choosing to hate? You know, if you look at the gifts of the Spirit, or if you look at the fruit of the Spirit, you look at the fruit of the Spirit, the opposite of love is hate. So you can go back and you can look at the scripture and you can learn something additionally just by understanding what the fruit of the Spirit is. The fruit of the Spirit's there biblically, and it gives you that sound doctrine in the Word of God. But you can go through and you can take it quite literally, and you can look at the opposite, and that opposite emotion will take you, and it will take you into the enemy's world. It will lead you away from God. So the opposite of love is hate. Are you choosing to love, or are you choosing to hate? Are you choosing joy, or are you choosing to be depressed? Are you choosing to live in peace, or are you choosing fear? What are you choosing? What are you choosing today? Because we need to be battle ready. We need to be battle ready. Because we've got a seat at the table. And God wants to see the fruit of our lives. He wants to see that godly fruit in our lives. He wants to see you functioning in love. He wants to see you functioning in joy, in peace, in goodness, in kindness. What are you choosing with your thoughts today? Life is cyclical. Life is cyclical. We live in cycles. I don't mean that we're walking around the same mountain like the Israelites did when they were walking around in the wilderness, never getting anywhere. I mean that life itself is about cycles. Time is about cycles. We experience 24 hours and then a new day begins. We experience 7 days and then a new week begins. We experience 28 to 31 days and then a new month begins. After 365 days, we celebrate New Year because a new year begins. Life is cyclical. So if we go back and we look at what Paul is writing about in chapter 12 of 2 Corinthians, he's caught up to heaven 14 years ago, and he's experiencing this beautiful vision, if you want to call it that. He said he didn't even really know what it was, whether he was transported there or whether it was a vision. So Paul is writing about the cycles of life. And numbers mean something. The number 14 means a completed work had happened in his life. It means that there was a completion. There was something that was completed in his life. He was delivered from level one, you know, because it says that he experienced this thorn in the flesh three times. He experienced it three times. So I'm thinking about this as a cycle, that our life is a cycle. So Paul is going through life. Does that sound like life? Where we're going through trials, we're going through tribulations, and then we experience something. We go through this testing season, we produce fruit, and that fruit is deemed worthy, and then we go from glory to glory. So when a work is completed, when that work had been completed in Paul's life, he was delivered from level one. He experienced his first thorn in the flesh, because it says that that messenger from Satan was sent to keep him from being proud. So he experienced his first thorn in the flesh. He went from glory to glory. Some of us can stay stuck here on that first level. We get saved, and then we start fighting things out in the spirit, and we don't ever go from glory to glory. We just stay right there in that presence. We never move. We don't go on. We're so focused in on our hurts of the past. But we have to keep on moving. We have to keep on growing. We have to keep on becoming spiritually mature. So when we make those godly choices in our lives, and the fruit is seen in our lives, and we are making those good godly decisions, we can go from glory to glory. So we move from level one, and then we go into level two. And at level two, there is a messenger that's sent from Satan, and we get another thorn. And we go through that process again, and Paul is continuing to progress, and he's making godly choices. And the time began, it begins for another level, and he goes through another level. And the time, he gets to his third thorn. He's at this third level, going from glory to glory, and he's at this third thorn that he experiences. And when the work was completed, he moved from glory to glory again. Doesn't this sound like life? It sounds like things that we experience. Going from glory to glory, going from level to level. There is a thorn in your flesh going out, just bothering you, whatever that thorn is. I can name three in my life right now, just like I could name Paul's. There are thorns in our flesh. But you know what happens in life? Sometime, at some point, you become spiritually mature enough that you understand that it's not the thorn, has nothing to do with the thorn. It's the process that you are going through. Because what you're going through is you are going through a refining process. The Lord is purifying you through that process. He's taking you from glory to glory. And as you draw closer to Him, He is refining you. He is making you better. It's not that you're not continuing to hurt from the thorn. It's just that you understand that the thorn is there to draw you closer to the Lord. That thorn is there. It still hurts. I know that Paul was still bothered by it. It still probably just irritated him. It may have even kept him up at night. He may have sat down and just cried for a few hours every now and then. But I can tell you this. He got himself together, because at the end of the day, he knew that that thorn was drawing him closer to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There was a spiritual maturity that was taking place in his life, and he knew that once he had reached that level, he could look back and he could say, okay, it doesn't matter what's happening with that thorn. I'm drawing closer to my Lord. I need to get closer to God. I don't care what the enemy's doing to me, but I'm going to stay the course. And I'm going to keep going, and I'm going to stay the course, and I'm just going to keep going. I'm going to sit at that table, and I'm going to glean from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm going to stay there and I'm going to ask him for more revelation. I'm going to ask him for more wisdom. I'm going to ask him for more of his glory, for more of his anointing, because that's what matters to me. Those supernatural blessings are what matter to me. That thorn, I don't care about that thorn anymore. That thorn is just something in the natural. I'm living a supernatural life now. I don't need anything in the natural. You can take that thorn and you can leave it there because I am a part of the King's table. I am a part of the King's kingdom. There is a glory that is on me when I sit at that table where I am completely transported to another level. I am moving from glory to glory to glory. Paul was becoming spiritually mature. He was becoming spiritually mature. He was spiritually mature through that process. It is a process, just like it is for us, a process. If you have been walking through that, if you have been experiencing thorns in the flesh, and you haven't given them over to the Lord yet, I encourage you to just leave them at the altar, to drop them down at Jesus' feet and just surrender them there. Say, Lord, I give them to you because I want the supernatural. I want to be transported to the King's table. I want to experience your glory. I'm not going to be burdened down by a thorn of the flesh, but I am going to hold on to the King's table. I'm going to hold on to my royal blood. I am going to hold on to my connection to you. And I don't care what the enemy does. I am going to press into more of you. Sometimes we beat ourselves up over past decisions, over bad choices, over past sins, over wasted time, over bad relationships that we went through and we feel like that they pulled us away from God. I could go on. I could go on. If we went around the room, we could all testify of something that we wish we had not done. But even God uses those things. In Romans 8:28, it says, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them." Living for God takes effort. It takes effort. I think everybody in here knows that I am a school teacher by day. When I was in the regular classroom, we had what we would call culminating projects. We would go through a 9 weeks, and we would learn all of the material from that 9 weeks. And at the end of the 9 weeks, there would be a culminating project. There was a project that we would go through. And it would really, the kids would have to go through it, they would have to create something, but in that creative ability, they would show us that they had learned all of the components that they were supposed to learn. And the reason why we did that is because a student could be a poor test taker, they might have low reading skills, they might not like to do their homework every night, and they might not have made the grades that they needed to make. So we were assessing their work ability, and we were not assessing their knowledge. That culminating project allowed us to assess what they really knew, because they could put things together and they could show us that they had mastered the material, that they had learned all of the material that they were supposed to learn in that culminating project. And I'm explaining that to you because God looks at our effort. He looks at our effort. He looks at what we've done, and he uses all of those things, even those bad choices that we've made, even when we didn't do our homework, even when we scored low on a test, even when we just weren't faithful with turning everything in like we were supposed to. He looks at our effort, and he uses everything for our good. Everything. He uses all things for our good. I don't know who hurt you. I don't know how you were devastated, but you made it through. And you did everything you needed to. So that project is complete and you're going to a new level. You have done everything that you needed to, and God is saying, I'm going to use it all for your good. I know that you're hurting. I know that you're broken. I know that you felt rejected, but I am telling you that breakthrough is coming because there is a new level that you are going to. It's time for promotion. It's time for advancement. It is time for you to go to the next level, from glory to glory. I will use it all for your good. I will use the rejection. I will use the loss. I will turn it around for my glory. I will turn it around for my glory. There's four reminders that I want to give you tonight. If I could tell you anything about this day, if I could give you four takeaways that I really want you to focus on this week, I really want you to focus on it this week. And the first one is, when you are reading your Bible, I want you to search for scriptures so that you can look for those scriptures that tells you your worth in the kingdom, that shows you your relationship with God, that tells you that you are a joint heir with Christ, that tells you that you are a part of the royal family. I want you to know your worth. I want you to focus on your worth this week. Know your worth. You are worthy. You are worthy. If I were to go into every church, if I were to go into every grocery store, no matter who they are, people, whether they're Christian, whether they are not Christian, we are struggling to understand our worth. There are self-esteem issues no matter who you are. But if you are a Christian, you are worthy. You are worthy because of your connection to God. And I want you to know that and take that away with you tonight. The second thing that I want to encourage you to do is to watch your thoughts. It's the second week that I've been talking about this. Watch your thoughts. Evaluate and assess your thought life. If you are focusing in on those negative things in your life, if you are dwelling on things that are ungodly, if you are dwelling on things, the what ifs, the enemy comes in and tries to get you away from Jesus by saying, what if this happens? What if you lose your home? What if the banks collapse? What if your dog passes away? What if you lose your job? There are so many what ifs, and the enemy tries to distract you, to discourage you, and to lie with the what ifs. Focus in and dwell on the blessings of God. You should spend more time dwelling on the goodness of God and the blessings of God. And I'm telling you, when you start to do that, you're going to see those negative things just completely fall from your mind. It's going to be a complete turnaround for you. If you have been focused in on negative things, if you've been focused in on depression, on discouragement, on just drifting away and trying to find your worth, when you start rearranging your thought patterns, when you start just walking through a healing that takes place through good, godly thoughts, you are going to see a turnaround. Your speech is going to be different. You are going to talk a different way. You are going to act a different way. People a year from now are going to say, you are so different. It is because you have retrained your brain to think godly thoughts when before the enemy was attacking you at every level. Third thing, examine people and examine your life by their fruit. Examine people and examine your life by their fruit. You should look for the fruit if you are trying to make a decision, if you are trying to decide on whether to enter a relationship or leave a relationship, you should look at the fruit. If you are trying to decide on whether or not to just enter into a contract, you should look at the fruit. You should look at the fruit. There should be good, godly fruit with the people that you are hanging around, with the things that you are wanting to do. If there isn't any fruit, you need to run. If there isn't any good, godly fruit, you need to run. It is going to draw you away from the Holy Spirit. It's going to pull you away from God. And it is a distraction, and it is a lie, and it is a way that the enemy is going to try and distract you and pull you away from God. Fourth thing, allow God to take you from glory to glory. You need to sit and just bask with the Holy Spirit. Sit and just sit in the presence of God. I want you this week to find time to just sit and to just listen to the Holy Spirit. I don't mean pray for 15 minutes. I mean just sit and let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Yes, pray. I'm not saying don't pray. Yes, we do need a prayer life. But the best part of prayer is listening to the Holy Spirit. That revelation that comes from our prayer life is going to be food from heaven. I'm telling you, you will get direction. You will get peace of mind. You will get an uplifting like you have never experienced before when you start listening to and drawing closer to the Holy Spirit. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, I thank you tonight. I thank you tonight, God. I just pray, Father, for each one of your people here. I know, God, that you have given me this message because there are people here who have been struggling with rejection. They have been struggling with depression, with doubt, with worry. But God, I just pray right now that you would just show them that they have a seat at the table. That they have a seat at the table. I just pray right now that you would stamp worthy on their heart. That you would stamp worthy on their heart, Lord. That they would know that they are worthy. That they would know that they have a place that's there, that's reserved for them. That is at that table, that is there and it's reserved and it's marked for them. That they are called, to your purpose that you have, Lord, and that you are making a way. You are creating open doors for them. You are creating opportunities for them. Lord, I pray that you would help each person to know their worth. I pray, God, that you would show us that we are worthy. I pray, God, for our thoughts to become godly, to become just anything that we are struggling with, those negative thoughts. I just pray, God, that they would be removed, that they would be completely removed. I pray that our brains would be completely retrained, that there would be a sanctification that comes through that process, Lord. I pray, God, that we would show, that we would see supernaturally how we need to make changes in our life, that we would be able to see the fruit, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would just come in and take us from glory to glory. I know that that is a process. I know that sanctification is a process. I know that spiritual maturity is a process. And Lord, I'm just asking you, come into this moment and grow us up. Take us from level to level, from glory to glory, God. We just thank you, God, for all that you're doing. We thank you, God, for our church. We thank you, God, for our family. Lord, I know that you are doing great and mighty things in our families. I know that you are doing great and mighty things in our lives. I know that you are opening up doors for our church. I know that you are opening up doors for our ministry, Lord. I know that we are going to walk into blessings, supernatural blessings, like we have never seen before. That it's just going to be falling down from heaven. That this place is going to be an open heaven that is just going to prosper. It's not going to prosper because of a person. It's going to prosper because of Jesus Christ being put on the throne, and that he will remain on the throne, that he is in charge of this church, that there isn't a pastor in charge of this church. This is Jesus's church. We are the remnant. We are the remnant, and we will remain the remnant because we are called. We are called, and Lord, we just know right now that you are doing something supernatural in this moment. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, for the word that went forth. We thank you, God, for this time of fellowship, Lord. And I just thank you. I thank you for every person that's here tonight. I thank you for every person that's watching. God, I ask you to come in and to be God in their situation. I ask you, God, if there's any person there that is struggling, I ask you to soften their heart, to soften their heart and draw closer to them. Lord, I pray that if there is someone that is struggling with just identifying with who they are in Christ, Lord, I pray that you would come in and just walk them through their worthiness. Stamp them as worthy. We know that we are worthy. We know that we are a part of a royal family, Lord. But I pray, God, right now that you are removing all of that rejection. All of that rejection is completely washing away in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father. I pray for just blessings, supernatural blessings throughout this week. And I ask for you to be with us as we are just walking through this next week, Lord. We ask you to come down and to be God on Monday through Saturday until we see you again on Sunday, God. And we just thank you, Father. Praise your name, Jesus. Amen.